Okay, assalamu alaikum and also good morning. Okay, yesterday we have learned about the transfer function of a linear system. Okay, so today we continue about the transfer function of a system. Okay, and basically today we will look into example that we have in the books, okay, which is related to a DC motor. So we're going to develop the transfer function for DC motor. Okay, as an example, let us obtain the transfer function of an important electrical control component, which is DC motor. Okay, a DC motor is used to move loads and is called an actuator. An actuator is a device that provides the motive power to the process. And DC motor is a power actuator device that deliver energy to loads. And as you know as well, that the DC motor will convert direct current, electrical energy, into rotational mechanical energy. Okay. Okay, a major fraction of the torque generated in the rotor or the armature of the motor is available to drive an external load. Okay, so this motor is basically is a quite a good example for us because it is a complex system where within that system basically there involves three type of components. Okay, as we know that one of them is the electrical component. Okay, because we have winding. And then there are also mechanical component because we have a rotating armature, okay. And beside that, there is a magnetic components, okay. So that's why it is a quite integrated system, okay, with three different components there, okay. So we try to model this DC motor so that later on we can and have the response equation, okay, that we can utilize to analyze the performance of the motor. Okay, this is the sketch of the electrical motor. Okay, this is the sketch in the form of mechanical drawing. Okay, this is the sketch in form of the electrical drawings. Okay, so the only thing, if you look at this electrical motor, okay, electrical motor, normally what you see is that there is a shaft coming out to the from the motor, which normally this shaft we use to attach with the external load, okay, so we can utilize it to drive something, okay, but attached to that shaft basically there is a rotating cylinder like this, okay, which it is called as a rotor, okay, or sometimes it is called as the armature, okay. And then on this armature, okay, some of the motor utilizing permanent magnet, but some of them utilizing wire winding, okay, so that it can generate the electromagnetic field, okay. And because of that windings, normally that winding will be connected to the power supply through the utilizing the carbon brush here, okay, because we need to switching the wire, okay. Okay, that's why we need to use the carbon brush here, okay. And this one is called the commutator, okay. This is where we connect the winding connector to the external power supply, okay. And then outside here, we have something that we call it as the stator winding, okay. The stator winding is basically stationary. It got a winding as well, and sometimes can be replaced with a permanent magnet. But for the winding, it got also, it will be connected also to the power supply, so that it can generate the electromagnetic field. Okay. So the only thing, the shaft normally supported by bearing. Okay, don't forget, although we use the ball bearing, but still the ball bearing still having the friction a little bit. Okay, so we need to consider that as well. Okay, and the shaft, the rotor, okay, because it got a weight mass, okay. That's why when it is rotating, we need to consider the inertia of the rotor, okay. So in schematic diagram in electrical, okay, for the stator winding, it is represented by this coil, this electrical circuit, where this is the supply voltage, okay. The stator winding normally we label with F. F stands for the field. Okay, because it's providing the magnetic field around the armature. Okay, so it is we consider as the field. Okay, so that winding, okay, we can represent this winding with resistor and also inductor in series. Okay, when we talk about winding, winding basically is a solenoid, okay. So for winding, basically it is a type of inductor, okay. So we can have the coefficient for the inductor, okay. And since the winding also we got a little bit resistant, okay, that's why we need to consider the resistant there, okay. So we combine this resistor and also the inductor in series, okay, to represent the coil winding, okay. And for the armature, we have the winding as well, and then this is the carbon brush, okay, and this is the commutator, okay. And it is also, because it is a winding, so we just label it with the L, because it is inductor, and of course it got a little bit resistor. So the A stand for armature, okay. Resistance for the armature, inductance for the armature, okay. And then we will produce the basically the current that is flowing here when we supply the voltage here. basically is equal, it is, the current is IA, okay? The current of the armature, okay? Here also will generate the current. The current is IF, okay? That's flowing through the to the resistor and also through the inductor, okay? IF is basically field current, okay? And this is the rotor and the shaft. So the rotor, if we apply the these two current, basically the magnetic field will be generated, and based on that magnetic field, normally it will force the rotor to rotate, okay, with certain velocity, okay. So the only thing with this rotor, we need to consider the mass, okay. The only thing, because it is rotating, so we need to consider the inertia, okay. And don't forget also we have the friction because of the bearing, okay. So this is the inside the DC motor, okay. From this physical component that we see here, okay, we need to develop mathematical models, okay, transform this to mathematical model, so that later on we have the transfer function for the DC motor. Okay, as before we learned that we may need the to do the linear approximation for the DC motor if the equation is not linear. Okay, we need to linearize them. And then after that, we need to get the differential equation. Okay, and then get the Laplace transform. And then finally, we need to get the transfer function. So all that step that we have learned, we need to apply it here. Okay, for DC motor are widely used in numerous control application. I think you're aware as well. For example, in robotic manipulator, okay, and then in tape transport mechanism, okay. In fact, if you look at your disk drive also, okay, the motor is being used also there. If you have the machine tool, like in our workshop, there are a lot of DC motor being used, okay, and also servo valve actuator, okay. And why it is being used, okay, because the DC motor basically having these features. First thing, the torques being generated by the DC motor is quite high, okay, that's why normally it's being used. And then the speed is controllability, speed controllability over a wide range. I mean that we can control the speed in quite a range of the torques, okay? And then the another thing is the portability, okay? Because when we talk about the mobile machine as well, a lot of DC motor being used, because we can just use a battery to operate it. And then well-behaved speed torque characteristics. Okay, this is the normally the motor, when you look at the catalog, they have the characteristic speed torque characteristics. So, and if we compare with different type of motor, basically the DC motor have a better characteristic than others. That's why it is always being used. And then the adaptability to various type of control methods. Okay, there are many way for us to control the DC motor. Okay. Okay, the transfer function of DC motor will be developed for a linear approximation to an actual motor. So we need to get the transfer function for this from this DC motor. Okay. And second order effects such as hysteresis and voltage drop across the brass will be neglected. Okay. Of course, when we model it into mathematical equation, some assumption we need to do. Okay. For example, there is a voltage drop when we use the brushes, the carbon brush. Okay. Such effect maybe we can also neglect to simplify our modeling. Okay. The input voltage may be applied to the field or armature terminals. Okay. If you notice that from the physical configuration of the DC motor, there are two circuit. One electrical circuit is in the stator winding, okay, or we call the field circuit, okay. The other one is in the armature, okay, where we call that as the armature circuit, okay. And with this, both of these circuit, we can control the voltage, right? Okay, we can control either the circuit, the voltage that we supply to the field circuit, or we can control the voltage that we supply to the armature. Okay, so to do control, there is a choice actually for us. Okay. Okay, let's look how we can model the system. Okay, we need to look at the field and also armature current first, okay, because this is basically the something that related to the magnetic fields that being generated by the circuit, and also later on that will move the armature, the rotor. Okay, the air gap flux, okay, the air gap flux of the motor is proportional to the field current, okay, provided the field is unsaturated, okay. So that we have the equation like this. This is the field, the air gap flux. Air gap flux is the equation for the magnetic fields. Okay. This one is proportional to IF. IF is the current that are flowing in the field circuit. Okay. So because this is a variable with the time, so we just write as small IF as a function of T. Okay, and KF is basically just a constant because we just know that this is air gap flux is basically proportional to. When proportional to, we just put a constant here. Okay. So we just put KF to indicate this is constant related to the field circuit. Okay? So that's one equation that we have, okay, related to the, which relating the magnetic fields to the electrical electrical current that is supplied in the field circuit. Okay, and then the other thing is that the torques developed by the motor is assumed to be related linearly to the air gap flux phi and the armature current as follow. Okay, so the torque that is generated okay, the talk to the motto. We say here, it is related linearly, we assume it is linear, related linearly to two things. One is the air gap flux, another one is the armature current. Okay? So when it is related linearly, same also, we just put a constant there, K1. Okay? The only thing, okay, we have the equation 1 for the air gap flux. Okay? So we can substitute this equation to replace the air gap flux here. So if we substitute, it will become like this. Okay? The torque of the motor is equal to K1 multiplied by KF multiplied by IF as a function of T multiplied by IA as a function of T. Okay? Okay, from this equation, if you look at this equation, this equation is a linear equation or non-linear equation. Why you said it is linear? Okay, for the above here, the equation 1, this one is a linear equation or a non-linear equation? Linear. This is linear. The second one? Linear. Are you sure it is linear? Okay. In this equation, how many variables we have? One. In this equation, how many variables we have? Okay. If we have two variables and we multiply together, is it a linear equation? No, right? So this equation is non-linear. Okay? And we need to make this equation linear so that later on we can use. Okay? We can use the linear theory, okay, to model our motor. So it is clear from the equation that to have a linear system, one current must be maintained constant while the other current becomes the input current. Okay? If we want to make this equation to become linear, what we need to do? Because before we said we have two variables, one is IF, another is IA. What we can do with this? Can we apply the linear approximation as we learned before? Because that one is only applied if we have only one variable, but that variable may be as a square or higher degree, okay? But it is not considering when we have two variables, okay? When we have two variables like this, okay, the easiest way to make it to become linear is to set one of the variables to become constant, right? Okay, either we make the IF become constant and let the IA become variable only, or we make the IA become constant and let the IF become variable only. Okay, so we have a choice. Okay, Okay? So it means that we either just control the voltage of the field, or we just control the voltage of the armature. Okay? Because if we control the voltage of the field only, basically we can vary the vary the current of the fields. If we control the voltage of the armature, we can vary the current of the armature. Okay. And if we fix the voltage, basically for the armature or for the current, basically that current will become constant. Okay. So first, we shall consider the field current control motor while maintaining the armature current constant, which provide a substantial power amplification. Okay. Kita akan cuba buat dua-dua, tapi pertama sekali kita cuba satu dulu. Kita control the field current. Okay. The armature current kita buat dia sebagai constant. Okay. Okay. Once we decide to make the armature current become constant, okay, so the field current only will be a function of S, right? Function of time before, okay? And then when we transform it using a Laplace transform, it will become a function of S. The other one is just become a constant, including the IA. Okay, so this K1, KF, KI, IA, basically will become, they are constant. So because they are constant, we can just combine them, become just one constant there, KM. Okay, so we will have now a linear equation where TM as a function of S equal to KM multiply by IF as a function of S. Okay? So this is a linear equation. And we have transformed it into a Laplace equation. Okay? In the S domain. Okay? Okay, KM, normally we call it as a motor constant. Okay? And this value, if you look at the catalog of the motor, normally it is given. What is the KM value for specific motor? Okay. Once we have decided that we want to control the IF, so we need only to consider the circuit of the field. Okay? And then from the circuit of the fields, we can utilize the what law we need to use? Kirchhoff, there are two laws. One is voltage, another one is the current. Which law is it? In this case, we need to use the Kirchhoff voltage law. Okay? Because we know here is a VF, okay, VF. VF is actually equal to the voltage across the resistor plus the voltage across the inductor, okay? So that's why we can come out with the equation. VF is equal to, okay, of course you can write first in the T domain, okay, or okay, or right away you can put it in the Laplace in the S domain if you who know, okay. Okay, so Vf is equal to voltage because across the RF. You know the RF, if we multiply with the IF as a function of S, basically will become the voltage across the resistor. Okay, and then here LF, if we multiply with the derivative of I, derivative of I as a function of T, okay, basically is equal to the voltage across the inductor. Okay, the only thing d over dt we replace with s when we transform into Laplace transform. Okay, I as a function of t we replace with the I as function of f, as a function of s. Okay, the only thing because there is if this side and if this side, we just factor them out, so the equation become like this. So everyone can follow? I'm sorry, sebab the di sini kita melangkah beberapa step. Okay, sepatutnya kita dapatkan equation dalam T domain, and then bila kita dah dapat, kita transformkan ke dalam S domain, and then lepas tu yang ini kita sebab dia sama, kita factorkan dia. Kan, bila kita dah ringkaskan, kita akan dapat equation seperti ini. Okay. Kalau tak faham, sila angkat tangan. Okay, and then afterwards, the motor torque, TM, is equal to the torque delivered to the load. Okay. This relation may be expressed as TM, the motor torque, will be equal to the torque yang kita gunakan untuk driving. Okay, bila kita torque kita gunakan untuk driving, don't forget the armature and also the shaft got mass. Jadi bila dia got mass, you need energy, you need a torque also to push that, to rotate that. Okay, so that is considered as the TL. Okay, TL is the load torque. When we talk about load torque ni, basically the torque that is required to rotate the rotor. Okay, and then plus TD. TD ni we consider as disturbance. Okay, we consider as disturbance. In fact, kalau you ada anything yang mana you connect to the shaft to rotate that external load, okay, that one is called as disturbance. Okay, the TD, the torque because of disturbance. So basically, the motor torque yang dihasilkan ni tadi, motor torque yang dihasilkan tadi akan digunakan untuk rotating the rotor punya torque, the rotor punya ni, the rotor, and also the external load. The rotor is basically the load lah, the internal load, dan juga the external load. Okay? Okay, however, the disturbance torque often must be considered in the system subjected to external force. Okay? Selalunya disturbance nanti bila kita applying the motor, okay, to drive something, selalunya kita consider that as disturbance. Okay? Kalau katakan motor tu kita tak connect kepada apa-apa, basically that TD will be equal to zero. Okay? Okay, the load torque, sekarang kita consider the load torques, TL. The load torque for rotating inertia is written as this one. Okay, you tahu ni equation apa daripada apa ni? Daripada hukum apa? Huh? Daripada Newton law kan? Okay, because in the kalau kita ada linear punya motion, basically summation of F equal to ma, betul tak? Tapi for rotational kita ada summation of the torques should be equal to J multiply by alpha. J itu apa? J is inertia, okay, and alpha is angular acceleration, okay. So you have the rotor there, where you got the J, okay, alpha, and then the you got the J because of the inertia, okay, and then because there will be speed, okay, when you are rotating, that's why you got the acceleration as well, okay. So the summation of the torques, this is basically if you look at this system, okay, the torques, there are two torques that we need to consider. One of them is the torque of the motor, the TM, just now. And then the other one is basically the torque to overcome the friction. Right? Okay? So because of that, okay, kita boleh tulis the TL, the torque because of the load ni. Sebab di sini kita ada summation of T. Okay. TL, kalau kita minus the friction, the force untuk atasi friction, okay, should be equal to J multiplied by alpha. Betul tak? Okay. The TL, kita minuskan the torque to overcome the friction, should equal to J alpha. Okay, so the only thing is that this is the TL, the torque because of the friction is basically this one. Cuma kita, dia sepatutnya sebelah sini minus, tapi bila kita bawa ke sebelah sini dia jadi positif. Okay, so this is the B multiply by the d over dt, d theta over dt, that is equivalent to speed kan, angular speed omega, right? Okay, sebab the torque untuk mengatasi this is friction is basically equal to b multiplied by the speed. Okay, that's why bila kita dah transform, kita akan jadi macam ni. Sebab ini, instead of speed, kita gantikan kepada angular displacement, yang mana dia akan jadi d theta over dt. Okay? Cuma d theta over dt, bila kita convert kepada S domain, gunakan Laplace, dia akan jadi d over dt jadi S. Okay? Theta t jadi theta S. Okay? Kalau you nak letakkan dalam bentuk omega pun, it's okay lah. Kan? Maksudnya B multiply by omega S pun okay. Okay? And yang ini adalah sama dengan ini. J is the inertia. Okay? And S square multiply by theta as a function of S, this equivalent to angular acceleration. Kan? Okay. Cuma yang ini, dia equal to d square theta over dt square. Acceleration kan? Okay, angular acceleration. Okay. Cuma kita dah transformkan dia dalam S domain. Okay. And then, satu lagi, kita anggapkan all the initial condition are zero. Don't forget that. Huh? Okay. Sebab kalau tidak, dia ada plus-plus something lagi kan? Bila kita transformkan dalam S domain ni. Okay. Okay, jadi based on this, kita akan dapat equation ini for the TL. Okay, of course yang ini kita boleh faktorkan lagi untuk simplify. Kita keluarkan S di sini, multiply by JS plus B. Okay, and the whole thing multiply by theta S. Okay, jadi kita dapat another equation. Okay. Okay, kita dah ada beberapa equation tadi, 4 equation, kan? If you recall back, satu equation ini kita boleh rearrange balik, kita letakkan sebab nanti kita punya output is theta, the angle of rotation. Bila motor ni selalunya, kita interested the output as is the theta, the angle of the rotation. So kita susunkan balik, okay? Kita susunkan balik supaya the theta become the output. Okay. Supaya the theta become the output. And then bila kita susun balik, kita akan dapati theta as a function of S is equal to TL as a function of S divided by S multiplied by JS plus B. Okay. Kalau you nak consider the speed as the output pun okay. Cuma bawa S ni ke atas. Okay. The omega S akan jadi TL as a function of S divided by JS plus B. Betul tak? Okay. Okay, the second equation yang kita telah ada tadi, kita ada ni. TL sama dengan TM as a function of S minus TD as a function of S. Okay. Nampak bila you ada equation macam ni, this is TL. Later on you boleh substitute equation ini ke dalam TL ini. Okay. And then, kemudian, the next equation yang you ada is equation ini. TM is equal to KM multiplied by IF as a function of S. Okay. Dan nampak this equation pun you boleh substitute ke dalam equation ini untuk gantikan TM. Okay. Dan seterusnya, kamu ada equation yang berkaitan dengan lita tadi. Lita of your fields. IF as a function of S equal to VF as a function of S divided by LF as a function of LF multiplied by S plus RF multiplied by F. Okay. Dan ini pun you boleh gantikan IF di sini. This equation. Okay. So kalau you do the substitution then, and then you boleh arrange supaya equation you akan jadi the transfer function seperti ini. The ratio between the input, the output, and also the input. Because here, the output we are considering is the theta, and the input is basically the voltage to the field circuit. Okay? Jadi kalau you dah gabungkan equation ini, you rearrange, you akan dapati the transfer function will be equal to Km divided by S multiplied by JS plus beta and then plus B. Okay, multiplied by LFS plus RF. Okay. ataupun you boleh simplify little bit more the equation supaya di sini coefficient dia jadi 1. Okay, you just bagikan dengan J dan you bagikan dengan LF. Okay, supaya di sini jadi 1, sini jadi 1. Okay, tapi jangan lupa di atas pun kena bagikan dengan J dan juga LF. Okay, so this is basically the transfer function of your motor apabila you lakukan the field control. Okay, maksudnya di sini kalau kita apply the voltage ni to the input, okay, kita just kalikan dengan ini, kita akan nampak what is the response. Okay, what is the angle, okay, of the motor. Okay, okay, ada soalan so far? Okay, daripada the transfer function equation, kita boleh bentukkan ke dalam block diagram. Dan kalau kita bentukkan ke dalam block diagram tadi, kita akan dapati block diagram dia akan berbentuk seperti ini. Okay, kenapa? Yang ini sebenarnya representing, this block diagram is representing the first equation, which is IF equal to this one kalikan dengan VF. Okay, and then the second equation, kita ada TM is equal to KM multiply by IF. Okay, and then the third equation, kita ada TL equal to TM minus TD. Okay, and then the last equation, kita ada theta is equal to 1 over S kali 1 over JS plus B kali TL. TLS. Okay, so actually kita sambung keempat-empat equation ini. And maksudnya output kepada the first equation akan jadi input kepada second equation. Kan? Input kepada second equation akan jadi output kepada second equation akan jadi input kepada third equation, dan output kepada third equation akan jadi input kepada the fourth equation. At the end you akan dapat the response. Okay? Okay, alternatively, the transfer function may be written in term of time constant of the motor as like this. Okay, yang ini tadi pun, kita boleh simplifikan dia lagi. Okay, instead of macam ni, tapi kalau kita buat supaya di sini jadi satu dan di sini jadi satu. Maksudnya, kita kena bagikan dengan B over J. Di sini kita kena bagikan dengan RF over LF untuk jadikan dia satu. Okey. Atas ni pun jangan lupa untuk kita bagikan dengan B over J dengan LF. Yang mana kita akan dapati J dengan LF ni akan cancel out, tinggal BR. Dan yang ini akan jadi di sebelah sini. Okey. Untuk LF over RF for this one. Dan ini J over B, 40L, tau L. Okay. Cuma kalau kita bentukkan dalam benda ni, seperti ini, tau F dan juga tau L, kita panggil sebagai apa? Time constant. Okay. Time constant for the fields, time constant for the load. Okay. The only thing, normally, kalau kita compare the time constant for the TL dengan time constant for the for the field current, for the field circuit, okay, kalau kita compare, biasanya TL adalah lebih besar daripada TF. Okay, dan dalam keadaan ini, yang mana kemungkinan TF ini kita boleh anggap dia terlalu kecil dan kita boleh anggap dia sebagai kosong. Kalau kita anggap tau F ni sebagai kosong, maksudnya kalau yang tau F ni jadi kosong, kita kalikan dengan S, dia akan jadi kosong kan? Dan ini akan jadi satu saja. Betul tak? Kosong plus satu basically become satu. Jadi at the end equation dia akan jadi di atas ni, constant di atas ini dibagikan dengan S, dibagikan dengan pole ini saja. Okay, tau L multiply by S plus 1. Ini akan jadi 1. Okay? Jadi dia akan lebih simplify. Okay? Sebab macam ni tadi dia jadi third order. Sekarang ni dia ada S kuasa 2 saja. Okay? Kalau tidak dia tadi jadi S kuasa 3. Okay? Jadi kita boleh ringkaskan kalau kita nak ringkaskan. Okay? Tapi kalau kita tak nak ringkaskan pun, kita just retain the tau F pun tak ada masalah. Okay, the next, kita lihat pula armature control DC motor. Okay, the armature control DC motor use the armature current as the control variables. Maksudnya, the IF tu akan jadi constant. Okay, the stator field can be established by a coils and current or a permanent magnet. Okay, field tadi sebab dia constant, kita boleh gunakan coil dengan voltage yang kita supply itu adalah constant, kita tak ubah, ataupun kita boleh tukarkan saja kepada permanent magnet pun tak ada masalah. Okay, when a constant field current is established in a field coil, the motor torque is basically, sekarang ni kalau you tengok, ini equation yang sama macam tadi. Cuma, tadi IF adalah variables. Tapi sekarang ni, bila kita gunakan armature control, IA akan jadi variable dan IF akan jadi constant. Okay? Jadi, the equation of the TM akan jadi KM multiplied by IA as a function of S. Okay? Okay, kalau kita gunakan permanent magnet instead of the field punya circuit, okay, dengan constant voltage, okay, yang mana equation dia pun akan lebih kurang sama. Cuma di sini, KM is basically adalah satu constant yang mana dia a function of permeability of the magnetic materials. Okay? Nah, ini pun sama jugalah kalau kita buka katalog of the motor, selalunya di supply value ini. Sama ada dia gunakan electrical circuit for the field ataupun dia gunakan permanent magnet. Okay, because kita control the current on the armature, okay, sebab tu kita kena consider the litar yang ada dekat armature. Okay, okay, di sini pun sama, kita kena gunakan Kirchhoff voltage law. Okay, cuma bila kita gunakan Kirchhoff voltage law, okay, voltage yang kita apply kepada armature ni, VA, adalah sama dengan voltage across the resistor, RA multiplied by IA, plus dengan voltage across the inductor LA, LA multiplied by S multiplied by IAS, okay, or derivative of IA. Okay. So that is the voltage across the inductor. And then kita ada tambahan satu lagi, VB. Okay? The VB is the back electromotive force voltage proportional to the motor speed. Okay? Faham tak apa benda tu? VB tu. Electromotive force voltage. Apa dia? EMF. Okay, bila you ada winding pada satu rotor and apabila dia rotating in a magnetic field, apa akan jadi? Apa akan jadi? Dia akan jadi generator, kan? Betul tak? Kalau you ada winding, you letak dia dalam magnetic field and then you rotate that winding, dia akan jadi generator, yang mana dia akan generating the current. Okay? So that is the result. Dia akan hasilkan VB, back electromotive force. Okay? And then VB ni, kita boleh tulis dia, sebab VB ni dia berkadaran dengan speed. Okay? Lagi laju the rotational speed, lagi tinggi the voltage. Okay? So kita boleh tulis sebagai KB multiply by omega S. Ataupun omega S ni you boleh tukarkan kepada theta sama dengan S multiply by theta S. Okay? So yang ini you ada equation ini, sebenarnya you boleh replace dekat sini nanti. So kalau kita gunakan, basically this equation saja yang berbeza dengan yang field control tadi. The rest sebenarnya sama. You ada theta sama. Okay, for the rotor. Okay, mechanically dia akan rotate. Jadi equation dia sama. Dan you have this equation for the load pun sama. Yang ini you boleh replace TL di sini. Okay. And then you have the equation of this one. Ini berbeza juga. Tadi IF, tapi yang ni IA. As a function of S. Okay? And then after that, you have the equation dekat atas ni. You boleh susunkan dalam bentuk ni, IA. Supaya you boleh gantikan IA di sini dengan equation ini. Okay? And then after that, VB, you ada equation ini. Okay? You gantikan dia. Okay? You boleh masukkan ke sini. Okay? Jadi, once you substitute that equation, those equation inside, ada lima equation tu tadi. Okay? Dan kita boleh rearrange. Okay? Cuma di sini kita consider TD sama dengan kosong. Okay? Dan kita boleh tulis the transfer function as the ratio between the output to the input. Okay? The output is theta S. The input is VA. Kalau tadi amateur field control VF. Ini sekarang VA. Because it is amateur control. Okay? And kita akan dapat equation macam ini. Okay? Dan ini kalau you kembangkan lagi, you kalikan, mungkin you akan dapat equation dalam bentuk ini, second order. Okay? However, for many DC motor, the time constant of the armature, LA over RA, is negligible. Ini pun sama. Apa? Maksudnya, yang ini, kan? Selalunya kita anggapkan telah begitu kecil, yang mana kita boleh anggapkan dia sama dengan satu. Okay? Kita anggapkan dia sama dengan kosong, negligible, and then dia akan jadi the whole equation ini akan jadi satu. Okey. Jadi bila kita buat macam tu, dia akan jadi equation tu akan jadi macam ni. Okey. Dan kalau kita simplify lagi dalam time constant, dalam bentuk time constant, kita akan dapat equation the transfer function jadi macam ini. Okey. Cuma the tau satu ni, the time constant ni, kita anggapkan sebagai this equation. So just nak tengok berapa slide lagi ada. Okey, cuma last saya tunjuk block diagram ini. Okey, daripada equation tadi, okey, yang mana kita akan dapat block diagram seperti ini. Okey, kita akan dapat block diagram seperti ini. Sama tadi, daripada sini sampai sini adalah one of the equation theta kepada TL. Okey. And then yang ini TL sama dengan TM plus TD, another equation. Okey. Cuma di sini sepatutnya kita boleh pecahkan kepada dua ni sebenarnya. Okey. Satu adalah TM kali KM. Okey. Yang mana that is one equation, TM kali KM which is equal to IA, okay, and then IA multiply by 1 over RA plus LAS, okay, kali dengan VA minus VB, okay, is another equation, dan seterusnya kita ada equation of VB sama dengan KB multiply by omega S. Okey, itu yang jadi loops tu. Okey. The back electromotive force yang menyebabkan dia menjadi macam loops di sini. Okey. Tapi ini sebenarnya bukannya loops. Okey, ini memang physically dia dah memang exist because of back electromotive force. Okey. And bawah ni adalah tables yang kalau you tengok daripada motor punya katalog, selalunya you akan dapati table macam ini. Selalunya akan diberikan what is the motor constant KM dan what is the JM. Okay, jadi kalau you beli motor, the time constant pun biasanya diberikan. Jadi you boleh refer to this value dalam katalog sekiranya kamu beli motor tertentu untuk kamu modelkan di dalam bentuk mathematics. Okay. Okey, kita berhenti di sini dahulu. Kita sambung kemudian minggu hadapan. Okey, sekian saja. Ada soalan tak? Okey, kalau tak ada, terima kasih. Kita jumpa lagi. Assalamualaikum.